animal. I'm in hell.
What the fuck is this man?
Austin Powers.
Doc said Michael Myers.
This is Mike Myers.
It should be the Halloween mask.
This is a Halloween mask.
No, the killer dude from Halloween.
Oh, you mean Jason.
No.
Welcome to season two of The Pilot is Dead. It's just like season one, except this time I'm standing on a giant f***ing pile of money.
And we gon' get this money. Keep a bad chick just to talk, you know the slack and the paint lip gloss. And we gon' get this money.
This is The Pilot is Dead. Hello, welcome to The Pilot is Dead. My name is Matt Dressel, and every week I take a look at a show that didn't quite make it past that crucial first episode. This week we're traveling back to 1990 to check out the CBS pilot Shangri-La Plaza, where I'm guessing the pitch was, what if we made a musical written by someone who's never heard music? But before we get to all that, let's have a word from our sponsor, viewers like you. That's right, season two of The Pilot is Dead is entirely viewer sponsored, so for just the price of a cup of coffee, you can help me buy a cup of coffee. Expensive. Unfortunately, that means we will be losing our old sponsor, Codex Art and Apparel. Before we say goodbye to Codex Art and Apparel, let's remember some of the good times we had.
I will remember you. Will you remember me?
But don't get too sad. Codex Art and Apparel will always have a place on this show as our censor bars.
Angelica?
Looks like you found me.
Aw, it's like they never left. Nope, we're not doing that anymore. This is season two. We're throwing out all the old jokes from season one, and we're starting fresh. There we go. And now it's time for our new viewer mail segment, Fanning the Flames, where we take a look at viewer comments and respond to them in a calm and controlled manner. Let's take a look at what people are saying. Fierce Stranger writes, why do you make some reference to pedophilia in every video? Thanks for writing, Fierce Stranger. For the record, I don't find your username creepy at all and would welcome you talking with my 7-year-old daughter online. And to answer your question, I will not be making any more pedophile jokes in season two. Pedophile jokes are offensive and have no place on this show. Thanks for writing, Fierce Stranger. For the record, I don't find your username creepy at all and would welcome you talking with my 7-year-old daughter online. Starting now. Another change for season two is there will no longer be any long tangents. We're not gonna mess around, we're just gonna get straight into the show. Wait a minute, what show are we doing again? Oh, right. If you're wondering who created this blatant Pee-wee's Playhouse ripoff, that would be Michael Myers himself. That's right, the original Michael Myers, credited as The Shape, was played by Nick Castle, who would go on to direct The Last Starfighter, Dennis the Menace, Mr. Wrong, and Major Payne, films so wildly different from each other, it reads less like a filmography and more like a series of mini strokes. The series starred Melora Hardin, who you might know as Jan Levinson on The Office.
Stealing kisses from me on the sly, taking time to make time, telling me that he's all mine.
The show also starred the hot bounty hunter from Critters as one of the romantic leads. No, the other one. There we go. And believe it or not, Chris Sarandon, star of Fright Night, Child's Play, and The Nightmare Before Christmas, has a blink and you'll miss it role, even though he's given top billing on the show. And Chris plays a character that makes Fisher Stevens' portrayal of Benjamin in Short Circuit look quaint.
Hey Fred, it is time to wake up, huh? The early bird gets worms. What is the time being?
But we'll get to that later. For now, let's dig into the show. Now, seeing as this is a musical, I can only imagine it has one of the catchiest damn theme songs in all of...
When it seems like the sky's falling down,
are you pointing to us?
Operations off the ground. Don't give up.
You're in luck.
I know a place where every man has a dream.
And every car has a space.
Here it calls.
Shangri-La.
It's not a mall.
Nope.
When your love life's up and stalled, drop on by and get your heart overhauled. Santa do, well, I'm sure it's nice.
But what we're talking about here is freaking hell die.
Hmm, half expected. Seriously, what in the hell is going on here? Who is this show for? What's that? Who's that person? Because she's never in the show. Look, I could devote an entire show just to the theme song, but we have a lot more what the fuckery to experience, so let's move on. So we're introduced to our two main characters, the Bondo brothers. One of them wants sex, the other wants love. They're the original Odd Couple. Or more accurately, the remake. Interesting fact, there was a cartoon remake of The Odd Couple called The Odd Ball Couple, starring a dog named Fleabag and a cat named Spiffy. Wait a minute, a dog and a cat living together? That would never work! Oh. So with the brothers' introduction, we get the first song, Mercedes and Ladies. Hey, that rhymes!
Mercedes and ladies, don't rhyme for nothing. It's a guarantee if you're looking to score. Ain't nothing better than Lisa against leather.
And with that, it's on to our next song. This is great. And that was This Is Great, available now on iTunes. The great thing about this show is you never quite know when it's going to be a musical. You'll think someone's starting a song, and then they'll just stop. People sing half their sentences in song, and other times they just kind of make up a melody as they go along. It makes for a truly confusing, sometimes maddening experience.
What a dump! What a jump! My ex, the donut! And you didn't respect the dead when the dead was alive. Postmodern, retro, American kitsch. You don't have to be rich to have style. And these Schlemiels missed it by a mile. Jenny, my love, I have a way to make this place pay off for us.
So basically, Jan's character hates her dead husband, the Donut King, and wants to sell his shop and move to Paris. And what a shop it is. I'd also like to give credit to this show for being progressive in a time where so few shows were, and casting a woman of color who didn't fit into some stereotype.
Decaf.
Decaf? And who do we think we are?
Well, never mind. I now present this clip without context.
Yo! Huh? Yeah, you! Yeah, you! Yo!
Who, me?
Yeah, you! Where you going?
What's the tea at?
Oh, an attitude.
She got the attitude.
Well, that's gratitude. Little lady's got an attitude.
It should also be noted that one of the teens is played by Savion Glover, one of the greatest dancers of our generation, most notably known for his work on Broadway in such shows as Bring In Da Noise, Bring In Da Funk. One of the greatest dancers of our time, and they gave him crutches. Crutches that are never explained, never utilized in any particularly creative way, and most of all, make you wonder why the hell would you give Savion Glover crutches? And this is not the time to fill the comment section with comments about how I'm an ableist. Wheels was my favorite character in the Burger King Kids Club. Actually, that's not true, it was Kid Vid. Okay, what's the next song?
I think it would be a lot easier if you just removed the fan bolt protector, slip in under the butterfly bolt, and pull up the slack with a 3/4 socket wrench.
Believe it or not, talking like this doesn't make whatever you say a song. You're grossly misunderstanding what music is and making us all suffer for it. Okay, so we're just about halfway through and it's time to kick off this love triangle plotline. It's the all-time classic battle of this guy versus this guy. Who will win? All I know is we get another song, so it's definitely not us.
Don't tell me I can't really care. Don't tell me I can't really care this time.
Bondo Brothers, your one-stop shop for auto repair and yogurt? And now I present to you the funniest joke in this show, nay, in the history of my entire series.
Mommy, did Daddy go to heaven?
No.
Good.
It's at this point in the show we come to what can be considered the only real song in the episode. It has a hook, it's fun, and most importantly, it's sung well.
A multitude of sins.
And if you overcook it,
overlook it. That's how you make the donut hole. Ha, ha. Donut!
It makes you forget for a second what you're watching. And then this happens.
Roses.
Nah, that's too pushy.
Daisies.
Oh, it's a little too friendly.
Irises.
Pushy, but in a friendly way.
So the two brothers declare their love for Jan, but she turns them down because she's moving to Paris. Or is she?
I said you have no assets. Your ex hacked this place up to the powdered sugar. All you've got is the lease on the donut shop and $942.
Muchas gracias. The rent.
Fun fact, that was an actual scene of Chris Sarandon picking up his check for this show and leaving. So we finally come to the main conflict of the series, the thing that will drive this show forward and give us 6 seasons and a movie. Will Jan pour that cup of coffee?
Coffee, please.
And so that's Shangri-La Plaza, an acid-fueled night terror that aired just once on CBS, causing senior citizens nationwide to think they were having a seizure. What would this show have looked like if it made it beyond this one episode? Only Nick Castle knows, but he's currently busy working on the new Halloween films. See you next time.
From Smith's Rogue Sanitarium, drove to Haddonfield, staked out his victims, yes, Fear Michael. Wears a creepy mask, yes, Fear Michael. Knifed Annie in a car, yes, Fear Michael. Nailed Bob to the wall.